spotlight stealer, story stalker, salt in the wound, piss taker, punchline grabbing, headline hogger. Not nice. Not a nice man to know. Spit in the eye, straight talker, shaker upper, elbow in the ribs, ego breaker, body shameless gossip monger, whiskey guzzling guzzle lover. Not nice. Of all the Sikhs, he was sicker. Pricker of pride, poker and pecker away at the accepted order, sparing neither man nor God. Not nice at all. Not a nice man to know. Half his heart in Lahore, half in Amritsar, one foot in Delhi, one in the gutter, son of a gun and Sir Soba Singh, malice towards one and all. If you're not expected, don't ring his bell. If you expect to be respected, go to hell. Not a nice man to know, I know. But I wish that I had known him longer. And I wish there were more like him in the world. Not nice to know. But they don't grow on trees, people like him. So it's worth remembering Khushwant Singh. Not nice, but he took us all under his wing. The young, the outspoken, the runaways, the rebels and poets, the broken things. And this is why we gather to sing of him. While he is laughing up there, in the place he didn't believe in, drinking a peg or three with the boss, who's still not the boss of him. So here's to the man who we know is not nice to know. But we want to know and go on knowing. Khushwant, Khushwant, Khushwant Singh.
Litfest of Khushwant Singh. They said, we've got to read this poem out. I don't know how many people will remember it. It's called Pickled in Rum. The horse and the mule live for 30 years and know nothing of wine and beer. The goat and sheep at 20 die and never get a taste of scotch and rye. The cow drinks water by the ton and at 18 is mostly done without the aid of rum and gin. The cat in milk and water soaks, and then in 12 short years it croaks. The modest, sober, bone dry hen lays eggs for others, then dies at 10. All animals are strictly dry. They sinless live and swiftly die, but sinful, ginful, rum-soaked men survive for 60 years and 10, and some of them, though very few, stay pickled till they are 92. Khushwant Singh always boasted that he's going to be a centurion, and he passed away just short of that. I met him in the year 2000.
Chafin. It was teasing and it was laughter and so on. So there was a lot to it and very few people get it, and he got it. And I really missed not having him over there. And every time I ran into a roadblock, and I ran into plenty of roadblocks, I think, damn, I wish he was here. So in memory of a man who very inconveniently died when he did, I'd like to tell you a story. Many of you here have probably heard me do some of his stories. My favorite are his stories that he wrote on the Interfaith series, because I think that they're just so spot on. They're so non-PC and they're still so relevant. And I think a favorite generally is the one with the two stray dogs who are on heat, who cause an entire communal riot. Yes, anyway, that's not the one that I'm telling today. I'm telling you a different story, which is actually called The Difference. And it's about an interfaith conference in Paris. So there's the World Congress of Faiths happening in Paris, and India decides to send its sons. They decide to send Haji Hafiz Maulana Abdul Salam Sheikh Sahib. Fakr Millat. The pride of the faithful. Maulana Sahib was a stout, short man with a spectacularly black beard, which he rubbed regularly with perfumed oil. He had thick specs, a testament to his prodigious erudition. And he was righteous of heart. He was one of those men who was, he was in thought and word and deed, he was so righteous that not only did he walk the righteous path, but any of his flock who'd ever gone astray had been pulled back onto the righteous path. Maulana Sahib had come on board with a mountain of luggage, which included two lotas. The lotas are plastic jugs which one would take with water to go to the toilet to wash oneself after. These are very specially made. They're very specific in design. They have a handle on one side and a little curved spout on the other. And no good Muslim would be without one. And Maulana Sahib had two. Along with Maulana Sahib, there was Shri Guru, Shri Swami, Mahaupadhyaya, Mahashastri, Shri Vishveshwara Anandaji. He was the beacon of light for the Hindus. He was also stout, and he was also bald, and he had a little body, you know, that little bit of a plait coming down from the base of his skull. But he had spent a lifetime lecturing on how everything that the West had come from ancient India. Everything. Religion, philosophy, mysticism, aeroplanes, motorbikes, cars, trains, everything. So you can see why he was deserving of being a beacon of light for the Hindus. He had also come on with a mountain of luggage, and his luggage included several jerry cans full of Ganga Jal, water from the Ganges, several dalda tins. Dalda tins are the old metal tins full of soil. Soil was when you washed your hands after going to the toilet. That's what you used. You used soil to wash your hands. And he had a lota. But not like the Muslim lota. This was a Hindu lota. Okay? This is not, it does not have a handle and it does not have a spout. There is nothing Muslim about this lota. This was a Hindu lota. It's a whole different shape. Obviously, that's where all the difference is. That's what it's all about. So much so that Swamiji would not even go to the toilet in the same toilet that Maulana Sahib had used. But they were on the train going from, so the first part of the journey is from Delhi to Bombay by train, and then they go by ship to Paris. Swamiji would actually get off at every station and go to the fields behind the station to relieve himself. He won't even use the same toilet. And then, of course, there was the representative of the Sikhs, KS himself. So the story is actually written in first person. And KS says that he had brought on board with him a pile of glossy magazines with particularly good quality centerfolds to keep himself busy. The journey is eventful and tense, but it was definitely worth it. Because when they get to Paris, they get to the symposium, they get to meet this really beautiful young lady. And I have to tell you, she wasn't one of those ladies that you normally see at religious conventions, and she didn't look like a religious lady either. From the way that he eulogizes her attributes, I think she was probably a lady of the night. And she doesn't just, it's not just that they meet her, but she comes forward to meet them. She seeks them out. And she's very, very interested in the fact that there are so many religions. She had no idea that there were so many religions. Now, I must tell you that this lady could not speak anything but French. And Maulana Sahib and Swamiji could not speak any French at all. So KS is translating. She's very, very interested that there are so many different religions. And she's very keen to know what is the difference between each religion. She's very keen to understand what makes each religion different. The sons of India are very keen to explain it to her. And so trysts are set up. And I say trysts because on the first evening, Swamiji is out lecturing and he's convinced KS to go and attend his lecture, but Maulana Sahib is free. He's free and he's more than willing to sacrifice his evening to give quality time to this lady who speaks nothing but French and he can't speak any at all, to explain to her what is it that makes Islam different from the other religions, if she will just come to his room, which is on the sixth floor of the hotel, later that evening. On the following evening, It is Maulana Sahib who's lecturing, and KS is going to attend his lecture, but Swamiji is free. He's also on the same floor, and he's also willing to give up all of his time to explain the difference to this lady. And on the third evening, KS feels that actually he should also, his religion should also get a look in. So the third evening is set aside for him. And he says that the lady came and she went, and she came the next night and she went again. And on the third evening, he's terribly disappointed because she doesn't come, but she sends a note saying, "Ça ne fait rien. Je comprends bien la différence." And I have to say, I was obviously a little bit slow. I read the story when I was very young, and I did not understand the punchline. And I read it again and again for many, many years till I finally got it. But you see what I mean about him getting it when it comes to the idea of the fabulousness and the beauty and so on of sex. But more than that, when I started writing the book last year, my first line was that it was going to be, my work on the Kama Sutra was going to be my secret formula to world peace. Because I think that's what actually removes all the differences. And I really wish he was here to help co-author it. But since he's not.